Today I'm going to show you how to create photorealistic art using only Blender. I would say it's so easy, but everything is more complex, and today I will show you some features of achieving this realistic result using only Blender. Welcome to another episode on my channel. Don't forget to subscribe, hit the like button, and let's start to create photorealistic art. So, I'm inside my Blender scene. As you can see, it's not so complex scene with one island and horizon trees, but it has a lot of small details, and this is one of the most important things on the way to create a photorealistic render. But first thing first, and at the beginning we must find some references. This is the first thing that you should start with if you want to create such realistic pictures. I use Pinterest to find interesting ideas for my art. I save as many references as I like, which may help me in my work today. And using the pre-ref, I organize references, creating a mood board for my further work. In general, I advise to you always pay more attention to the search for references and keep the ideas that you like. Many artists neglect this stage of work, considering it's not significant, but it's perhaps the most important part to get a good and realistic result. Even doesn't matter what you try to create, photorealistic render or simple concept art, references are must have. So this is a mood board I have for work, and now we can open a Blender and I'll tell you the second feature which may help you to achieve realism in a Blender. The next step to achieve realism is using high quality models and textures. Many artists also neglect this factor, but using high quality textures allows you to make realistic materials, also complex materials. Adding dirt and combining materials may help you. For example, this water. This is how the render looks just if I make a simple water material and add a little bump simulating waves on the surface. It looks realistic, but I can add a dirt map to the material, slightly change the effect of this map on the material using color ramp, and our render already looks more detailed and interesting. The most important things to achieve photorealism is small details. As we can see in the references, for example here, some leaves floating on the water. Let's try to do this in a Blender. For this, I'm going to use scatter add-on and these leaves. But I want the leaves to appear only in foreground, except the middle and background parts, because it will be hard to see and really don't need so many details for further plans. I have a mask that can show an add-on where I wanna scatter my objects. Select this surface and go to texture paint mode. Here is my mask. Let's see how to create this mask step by step. This is my water material, and I add a new texture image. Name it and increase the resolution. Leave black color for base texture color. Usually I use 4K, you may use 2K or 1K depending on your computer. So I created an image texture, and in the texture paint mode I can draw a white mask where I want to see leaves. Then I use this texture as a mask and a scatter and add or remove part to impact where I want to see leaves and how it looks like in my camera. If we look at the example, we can see that leaves do not float on the surface. Some of them are slightly floated and some of them are partly above the water surface. To achieve this, I just make a copy of the water surface which I used for leaves and where I draw a mask and move this plane a little bit down under my main water surface. Hide the plane with leaves from the render and done. Now leaves will be more randomized on the water surface. So there are small details, but our brain is used to watching these details in the real world, everywhere. In the world there is no absolutely flat surface or absolutely clear color, and we must think about it if we want to create some nice realistic render in a Blender. Alright, since we already started doing foreground, let's talk a little bit about models. As I said before, the path to realism also lies in the use of realistic models or scans. But there is an important point for optimization the scene, because scans are quite heavy and can complete the work if you are working on a weak computer. So remember, for the foreground you need to use high poly scans like LDO, and gradually this factor decreases to 4 or even 5 degrees for the background. It's not necessary to use too many detailed models where this will not be visible. The further away from the camera, the less detailed model can be used. In this example, I have a lot of fog and can generally use low poly models for the background, since they still only look like a silhouette in the render. Yeah, photorealism also requires a lot of resources, so you need to think about optimization from the beginning so that later you do not get out of memory or crash your render at all. In general, you need to look more at the references and try to reproduce them into your art. I see how grass looks like here and do it in a blender, also trees, leaves and other details. That is why references always should be in front of your eyes. If you don't have a second monitor, you can use a blender because it also allows you to add images. For example, I just make a screenshot of this part, then I'm going to open image editor in a blender, drop this image here and it will always be in front of my eyes right in the blender. You can also add other images that are necessary for your work and work free even with one monitor and blender. But you must understand the importance of references not only for achieving a realistic result, but for work in general. The next step to achieve realism is the camera. I will not dive deep into the basic principles of photography and how real cameras work. The main thing you have to know is that camera do not make a photo with an absolutely clear image at the depth of the frame. Depending on the distance to the object's focus and aperture or f-stop, the camera focusing on the object will blur objects that are not in focus. In the Blender camera setting we have a depth of field checkbox that you probably noticed. To see how depth of field works, you need to turn on depth of field here. This will help to turn your Blender camera into a real one. So we turn on and then we need to understand where our focus should be. Of course the main object here is the island, so it will be the focus center. Next, using the f-stop parameter, we can adjust the aperture parameter of our lens. If it looks complicated and not clear, then in shots it's smaller the value, then more the focus you get. But to achieve photorealism, it's easier to use a photographer add-on, which has more correct values of f-stop parameter corresponding to real lens data. Despite this, the add-on itself has many settings for working with the camera and effects like film grain, distortion and exposure. But the most favorite scenes of this add-on is that you can set different frame size for each camera. For example, I have a horizon frame, but I also want to create a vertical one for my Instagram. By the way, subscribe to my Instagram. So I just choose resolution for another camera corresponding to the vertical frame, and I can simply switch between cameras without changing the frame size additionally, having unique settings for each of the cameras. Back to depth of field. I want to do some depth in my render and make the foreground a little bit blurry. I have focal length of 24 mm, so I understand that somewhere at f5.6 I can count on such an effect. Now it's clearly visible as the foreground in defocus. For example, how does it work if I use the minimal value of f-stop? See difference. The lower f-stop value, then more blur on object closer to the camera. To understand more about it, take a DSLR or mirrorless camera and spend a day photographing to understand how depth of field works, when and how it appears. Or see the channels of professional photographers, because it's very necessary information for digital artists. Camera in your Blender scene, it's not a simple object, it's a tool, and you can understand how to work with to achieve different results in your art. You can also write in the comment below if you want to know about the camera more. Maybe I will return to this topic in the future. For a realistic picture, we need light. In almost every video I talk about how light is important for art and I pay a lot of attention to light. Let's look at collected references. I like this light and this light. Let's create something between these options, fog and sun. Alright, for the main light I will use standard Blender sky texture and volume as a fog. And magic is just in the last one. Turn on viewport shading, firstly without volume, you can see the difference. We can adjust the setting of the sky texture here, rotate the sun elevation and other settings as you wish. It doesn't look super realistic, yes? Now I turn a cube with volume scatter material and see the difference. It's much better. According to the desire, you can edit density and color to make the atmosphere. For this project I make several lighting options and let's see how quickly we can make two or more renders with different lights from one scene. In shader editor I choose world instead of object. Here all the settings for global light. If you use HDRI, it will also appear here. Here is sky texture, which completely duplicated the settings we made here. But in shader editor, I can duplicate this sky texture. Of course, it must be connected to world output. Why? For example, I like my light, but I want to produce a different angle of the sun or make another settings without messing up my base setting here, or generally want to make a completely different light with HDRI. Let's connect to world output to see how it works. Then change to previous one and get another light and render. So using different maps you can get different effect while my scene remains unchanged. If you create light and don't want to change this but need another light, this way can help you create different settings. We built the scene, made good details and materials, so we can go to compositing to make a post-production. I already have settings corresponding to different types of light. Let me turn everything off and tell you step by step how to make a very cool picture from your render without Photoshop. The first thing I do is slightly make a foreground darker, which will give the render more depth in accordance with the different types of light. To do this, I will add a simple box mask corresponding to the width of my frame and blur it to make this mask more soft. Next, I will use this as a mask for mix node, where I mix a simple gray color with my render using multiply type. Look at how it works. Possible to change the color to add a lower or higher effect of impression of this mask. Then color grading. Using a color balance node, I can make color tone for shadows and lights. In this node, you can experiment with color grading as you wish. It's so useful node for post-production in Blender. So for this overcast render, I pull gamma to cold tone and do the same for the gain. If you are not familiar with lift gamma gain, lift related to shadows, gain to light, and gamma I guess everyone knows. Using brightness contrast node, I slightly increase the contrast of the image. In accordance with the mood of my render, I will reduce the saturation in the hue saturation node, and with the help of the hue correct node, I work with colors in details. This is autumn, so I can slightly raise the yellow and red colors, making it more saturated, and remove the green to accordance with the autumn color tone. And the final magic is glare. This is the film grain node that was added in accordance with the camera settings in the photographer add-ons here. This add a little noise, something we talked about. This setting is for sunlight render. It was built by the same principles. I just use here flower image here to increase the effect from the sun and use the different color gradient settings in the color balance node. Starting with Blender 3.5, we can do real-time compositing right in a 3D viewport. To do this, I will open compositor in this window to make a visible effect from compositing and turn on for the camera here. As you can see, this is all we just did at compositor. We can do compositing directly in 3D viewport or by making it here work further with the scene, but here you will see the results that correspond to the settings in compositor. The only thing is that not all nodes work in 3D viewport compositor and may not correctly display the result. We must take it into account. Compositing in a Blender is not as fast as the same programs for compositing like Nuke or Fusion, and quite often can replace the result with a delay, even with an RTX video card, as for example here. When adding a mask, we need to wait some seconds to see the result, and this is a full HD render. Usually I make the final render 4K or 6K. But compositing provides opportunities to make digital art in a Blender without other software. Also, using compositing in a Blender, you can optimize the work process if you do not have a very powerful PC or have a very heavy scene, using rendering by layer and then combining parts of render layers in compositing. I guess we will talk about this way in some next video. It's also an interesting topic, especially for beginners. I hope this video was useful for you. As usual, I ask you to share this video with your friends, hit the like button and subscribe if you still not subscribed to my channel. Summer is over and that means I will have more free time to make interesting videos about Blender and Photoshop for you. So I hope to see you in the next episode.